In the late 1960s, prominent art collector Peggy Guggenheim purchased a painting by Fernand Leger. Leger was one of the most important Cubist artists, and this painting was part of his landmark series from the 1910s called Contraste de Forme. Guggenheim bought the painting from a reputable gallery, and all its paperwork seemed to be in order. Its line of ownership was well documented for the previous 15 years or so. She planned to add the piece to her already impressive Cubism collection, including some works she had bought from Leger himself. But several years after the painting's purchase, an art historian expressed doubt about the authenticity. This historian specialized in Cubism, and Leger had personally given pieces of art to him, so the guy knew what he was talking about. But for 40 years, no one could definitively confirm the painting's authenticity or prove it was a fake. The canvas was put into storage, where it languished until 2013. That's when an unlikely team of detectives decided to try something no one had ever used in solving an art forgery case: nuclear bombs. Museums have an impressive toolbox of methods for busting art forgeries. The first line of defense is usually the painting's provenance and its style. A curator examines provenance by tracing the line of ownership, ideally all the way back to the artist themselves. Gaps in ownership, or unverified links in the chain, might indicate that some funny business took place. Has anyone else read The Goldfinch? A talented historian will also consider a painting's style: the composition, brushstrokes, colors, and even sometimes the way an artist tends to paint an ear or something can be compared to other paintings by the artist. In the case of the Leger painting, both the provenance and style were questionable. There was a long gap between the painting's supposed creation date and the beginning of its paperwork, and it had been relegated to storage precisely because of a historian's doubts concerning the style. The next layer of investigation takes an even closer look with microscopy. As a painting ages, the paint itself cracks, and sometimes forgers just draw on these crack lines. Zooming in with a microscope or even just a magnifying glass can quickly unmask these deceptions. But this method has the most potential for very old paintings, when the layers of paint have had plenty of time to age. For a relatively young painting like the Leger, optical examination often doesn't turn up conclusive results. A more useful method for the Leger canvas was X-ray imaging. With the help of X-rays, scientists can determine the pigments used in each color of paint. In this case, researchers looked at the painting in question and a verified work by Leger. They noticed that the colors in each painting had different chemical formulas. What's more, the pigments in the questionable painting seemed to come from organic sources, like plants and animals, while the confirmed painting used synthetic pigments made from designer minerals. Which is weird, but it isn't totally out of the question that Leger might have just been trying a different brand of paints. As a last-ditch effort, scientists can perform mass spectrometry. This method requires a sample of the paint or the canvas, but the catch is that the sample will be completely vaporized. The vapor can then be separated into individual molecules to tell you exactly what it was made from. This is most useful for studying the stuff that holds the paint together, called a binder. For oil paints, that's, well, oil that typically comes from a plant, like linseed, poppy, or walnut. But newer paints might have fancier binding chemicals to make them dry faster or crack less. So if you do mass spectrometry and find paint binders that wouldn't have existed when the painting was supposedly created, well, then you've caught yourself a fake. The main problem with mass spectrometry is that it's destructive and requires removing a chunk of the paint or canvas. If you're having trouble getting conclusive results from non-destructive methods, then it's a huge risk to remove any part of a potentially authentic painting. The X-rays had turned up questionable results in the Leger, but nothing to suggest the painting was created during the wrong time period. And given the invasiveness of removing a paint sample for mass spectrometry, it's not surprising that they opted not to try it. So the painting sat for 40 years, and for a long time, it looked like it was going to be one of the many artworks that get permanently tucked away, because no one knows for sure if they're legit. But in 2013, a team of nuclear physicists decided to take a crack at solving the mystery. They were going to try carbon dating. But before I tell you more about what they learned, a quick ad.
This SciShow video is supported by Brilliant, an online learning platform that helps you build knowledge at your own pace. Even with the flexibility of an online platform, you get lessons developed by experts from MIT, Caltech, Microsoft, and Google. So your learning experience is supported by real expertise and a way easier commute than attending their lectures on campus. From their years of experience, you can learn everything from coding to calculus, which means you get to learn from the best no matter what area you're interested in. You can try it for free at brilliant.org/SciShow by scanning the QR code on screen or clicking on the link in the video description, and you'll get 20% off an annual premium subscription.
Carbon dating involves counting the number of radioactive carbon-14 atoms that exist in a sample. Carbon-14 is naturally created when cosmic rays interact with our atmosphere. We know how often those interactions occur, so we can reliably predict and measure how much carbon-14 exists in nature. It's about 1.15 carbon-14 atoms for every trillion non-radioactive carbon-12 atoms. Because it's radioactive, carbon-14 decays into nitrogen-14 with a half-life of about 5,700 years. So however much carbon-14 you started with, in 5,700 years, you'll only have half that amount. And in another 5,700 years, it'll get cut in half again. So on and so forth. Based on how much carbon-14 is in a sample, you can tell how long the carbon-14 has been decaying, and you can determine roughly how old the object is. I can hear you saying, hold on, if the half-life of carbon-14 is more than 5,000 years, can't it only be used for super old stuff? How does this help with a painting from the 1910s? And you're right, that's usually the case. But everything changed in the 1950s and 60s, thanks to the testing of nuclear bombs. The atomic age was marked by extensive nuclear detonations. The first above-ground nuclear test happened in 1945 in New Mexico, which you might have learned about during the Barbenheimer summer. But testing expanded and accelerated in the following decades as the Cold War ramped up. Those tests shot radioactive byproducts high into the atmosphere, including carbon-14, and the fallout drifted across the entire globe. Enough carbon-14 was generated by nuclear detonations that the atmospheric concentration of carbon-14 quickly doubled. The fallout was so extensive and concerning that most nuclear testing was banned in 1963. But all that carbon-14 had to go somewhere. It won't decay for thousands of years. In the meantime, it has gotten into the cells of every living thing, since we build our bodies from carbon in the environment. Plants draw carbon from the air, and for every trillion carbon-12 atoms they absorb, they'll also pick up one or two carbon-14 atoms. Animals, including humans, eat those plants and repurpose the carbon throughout our entire bodies. From the moment you start living until the moment you stop, you're picking up carbon-14. You have a carbon-14 signature. Your cat has a carbon-14 signature. And the seeds that are harvested to create oil paint binder have a carbon-14 signature, as do the plant fibers that are eventually woven into canvases. Carbon dating used to require several grams of material, but can now be conducted with as little as a few milligrams. The sample is vaporized, and mass spectrometry is used to count the ratio of carbon-14 to carbon-12 atoms. With just a tiny sample, you can pin down the date of an object to within a 1 to 3 year window. See, all that nuclear testing created a characteristic spike in the concentration of atmospheric carbon-14. The spike starts in the 1950s and drops every year as the carbon-14 in the air makes its way into organic matter. Because the graph changes so rapidly from one year to the next, it's possible to precisely match the date of an object to the concentration levels in the graph. So by using just a couple threads of canvas, the physicists were able to perform carbon dating on the Leger painting. The canvas contained a relatively enormous amount of carbon-14. 1.29 parts per trillion. That might not sound super drastic, but it is far too much for the canvas to have been created in the 1910s. The material for the canvas was definitely harvested after the bomb peak, made with plants from either 1959 or 1962. And considering Leger died in 1955, things don't add up either way. The painting was undeniably a fraud. Since the Leger case, other forgeries have been uncovered using carbon dating, including one where an old canvas had been painted over with historically accurate paint pigments. But even with these painstakingly detailed replications, The oil paint binder from recently grown crops was a dead giveaway. We're now back to pre-nuclear concentrations of atmospheric carbon-14. So you might think foragers would be back in business. But scientists predict that by the end of this century, we'll actually drop below the pre-nuclear concentrations. This is because we've been burning a lot of fossil fuels and adding their carbon to the air. Fossil fuels are so old that they have almost no carbon-14 left in them at all. So the atmospheric carbon-14 is actually being diluted and will eventually extend the bomb peak curve into negative ranges rather than bottoming out at natural levels. Future forgeries might run into the problem of not having enough carbon-14 to be convincing fakes. It's fascinating to know that every living thing carries a carbon-14 signature within them. We can tell exactly when something started and stopped living. You can be carbon dated, Peggy Guggenheim could be carbon dated, and the forgers themselves. Even things we don't usually think of as alive, like paintings, can be carbon dated. It's one of those things you just can't fake. You either have it or you don't. So, if you're a budding forger, maybe apply your artistic skills to original works and avoid doing any art crimes for the foreseeable future.